What makes boxing different? It's a sport of extremes, as we proved tonight. Top of the bill, a battle of the little big men.
Lennox Lewis is British boxing's biggest star and Britain's biggest sports earner. And everything about his heavyweight showdown with 6'7" Michael Grant this month is big. But at the other end of the scale, 5'1" of Francis Ampofo, and a man even he looks down on, 4'10" A.D. Lewis.
The pocket battleship, Francis Ampofo!
From Betty, the mighty Adam himself, A.D. Lewis!
Heavyweights get like £1 million a fight. I believe that's a good money for them, but we deserve a lot more than that.
Smaller fights, I think, are better fights if you watch them. More skill in them than the heavy guys, aren't they?
But these two are aggressive all-action fighters, each with 12 knockout wins in 17. They've both been British champions. In so many ways, mirror images of each other.
Both aggressive guys with all fights come forward. It's going to be an aggressive fight. It's going to be good.
I'm Pocket Battleship, and he's the mighty Atom. And I mean, when we both meet together, it's going to be a big explosion.
Not much to choose any way you size these two up, but at the York or Bethnal Green, one is definitely on home territory. And Ampofo's 12th appearance here. Lewis has been around, but fights here for the first time in his career. Both have always been value for money men. And both, maybe, have got lucky this Saturday fight night. They can walk away with the most valuable prizes in their careers. The Lonsdale belt bottom of screen for the British title and the Commonwealth title belt up for grabs as well. So small is beautiful, don't take my word for it. Jim and Barry are here to prove it. Barry, we often marvel at the skills of the little men, but these two have a little more to offer, don't they?
Indeed they do, and both of them would agree that they're in the twilight of their career. But the clash of styles suggests this could be a fantastic little fight if it goes well for both of them.
It would have been an excellent fight in the flyweight days at 8 stone, Jim. Now they've got the extra 6 pounds at bantamweight. Who do you think is more advantaged by that?
Probably Ampofo is more comfortable at the weight. He's been a bantamweight longer. A.D. Lewis at 4'10", obviously, would be a greater force at flyweight. But I don't think this fight's going to be about weight. I don't think weight's going to be the deciding issue here. I think it's what they've got left in the tank. And I have a feeling maybe A.D. Lewis will have a little bit more left in the tank.
And not height either. Ampofo 5'1" against 4'10" of Lewis.
Yeah, indeed. They're both little small guys, but they can fight, I can tell you. And we've seen examples of that in the flashes of performances they've had before. They're both in great condition. They're a pound in the difference. And it's all about, to my mind, just to enhance what Jim has said, it's about who wants it the most, who still has the desire and the ambition. Home territory will mean a little advantage to Ampofo, but it's about who wants it the most.
That top of the bill coming a little later here live, but we get the action underway with the return of the light welterweight. Buzzing division in Britain right now. Glenn McClarnon is in action on this card tonight. Prospect, 10 wins in 11, but he lost his unbeaten tag last time out and needs to overcome the mental hurdle immediately. Former Commonwealth champion Bernard Paul is up against him tonight. Jim Watt will join Ian Dark for commentary. His bantamweight days sadly behind him. Master of ceremonies, John McDonald.
Ladies and gentlemen, a very good evening and welcome to the legendary York Hall Bethnal Green for tonight's championship boxing. Proudly presented by Ringside Boxing Promotions and sponsored here by AutoDigital.com. A very warm welcome to our viewers joining us live here on Sky Sports and our listeners here on TalkSport 1089 1053 medium wave. All the officials have been appointed by the British Boxing Board of Control here present with us at ringside. Our steward in charge is Mr. Cecil Ross, JPMBE. Our inspectors Bob Longhurst and Richard Barber. Our three doctors here at ringside, Dr. Uttar, Dr. Griffiths and Dr. Hutchin. Well, they are the officials, and here are the contestants. We are in the light welterweight division. Firstly, and introducing to you, fighting out of the blue corner, he's wearing the maroon trunks and weighed in at 10 stone and quarter pound. He brings a 34 fight record, 21 wins at 10 inside the scheduled distance, 9 defeats and 4 draws. He comes to the ring as the former Commonwealth light welterweight champion from Tottenham, Bernard Poole. And across the ring, fighting out of the red corner, he's wearing the dark blue trunks and weighing in at 9 stone 13 pounds, brings an 11 fight record, 10 wins, 4 inside the scheduled distance, and only 1 defeat. He's from Logan, Northern Ireland. Would you please welcome Glenn McClarnon? Time to give the bell is Michael McCann, and referee in charge of the action is Richie Davis of Kent. This is 8 3-minute rounds.
And this could be quite an interesting fight, maybe a last chance for Bernard Paul.
You must defend yourselves at all times. You hit with a knuckle part of the closed glove above the belt. If one of you goes down, the other goes to the furthest neutral corner. You do not come out until I say so. One thing I absolutely insist upon, fellas, is when I say break, you both take that step back. Have you got all that? You got all that? Shake hands now. Good.
And there's Glenn McClarnon, who was unbeaten until losing last time against Chris Barnett of Manchester in an intercontinental title fight last November. That put a dent in his record. Can Bernard Paul resurrect his career tonight? He's coming off a four-round demolition at the hands of the excellent Ricky Hatton, the former Commonwealth champion Paul, in the maroon trunks here and the blue of McClarnon from Lurgan in Northern Ireland. 25 years of age, 9 years younger than Paul, who can be dangerous with his right hand. Certainly in the best years of his career he was. I think the question really though, Jim, being quite brutal about it, has Paul got anything left?
Yeah, that is the big question. I mean, already a couple of little stumbles concerning his balance right at the first bell, so take a couple of rounds before we can make our minds up, but he's had a fairly tough career behind him.
McClarnon looking dangerous with hooks to the body early on. Paul, born in Mauritius but based in Tottenham, North London. He's lost 5 of his last 6. Now that's a good right uppercut from McClarnon, who'll be looking to get his career right back on track. They have some hopes of him in Northern Ireland. Certainly can't afford any slip up here if he's going anywhere in this business.
A young fighter on the way up never wants to lose 2 fights on the turn. I mean, that takes a little bit of getting back from, so McClarnon will want to stamp his authority here pretty quickly.
Paul covering up quite well, but 1 or 2 of the shots were getting through. Steady on his legs from time to time, Paul, like his balance isn't quite what it should be. And if his boots are gripping properly.
Well, it's the first thing I noticed, right, that the first couple of seconds of the first exchange they had, he didn't seem too happy. It looked like as though he was struggling with his balance. And that's a worrying sign. McClarnon looks by far the sharper in the first couple of minutes that we've seen already.
Good right hand from McClarnon there.
Paul's experience, he'll be hoping he can come into play.
Getting the gloves up, Paul, but he's having to do that a lot, go into his shell in this opening round. If Paul was to lose again here badly, they would have to think about a permanent retirement. He is really struggling to get a grip on this canvas with the soles of the boots, you know.
Yeah. It looks as though he's at the end of a hard fight instead of the beginning of one.
Oh, McClarnon, really. Welcome back to the York Hall in Bethnal Green. Pretty packed as always on fight nights. Main undercard bout in the ring here.
Well, McClarnon certainly got off the mark a lot quicker in the first round. They clearly won that round.
Second ball, round short the road.
Second round. Glenn McClarnon on the far side from you now in the blue trunks, the maroon of Bernard Paul, the former Commonwealth champion at this weight light welter, where there are a lot of decent fighters domestically just at the moment. McClarnon will be looking to get among them in the next couple of years if he can keep his career going the right way.
only his 12th pro fight tonight, though. Bernard Paul in the ring for the 35th time. 9 defeats on his record, but usually against the top domestic operators.
There's no snap in Paul's work, no leverage in his punches. If he doesn't get himself balanced properly, then he can't expect to find some power.
Gaines sliding on the soles of his boots. I don't know if he's really unsteady on his legs or if he's just got a problem there with the boots. Might be a mixture of both.
Well, there's certainly something wrong. He can't even set himself properly to let the punches go. So there's certainly a problem. Maybe his boots right enough, I don't know.
McClarnon hoping to look good here, getting a little TV exposure and put up the bill tonight. It's a good opportunity for him to get a name on the record. He's got 3 first round wins, 1 second in his career already. Beaten solid journeymen like Marc Ramsey a couple of times. Can Paul make an argument of this? He really does look very tentative, doesn't he, Bernard Paul here?
He just can't seem to get an attack mounted, you know. No snap in his punches, no sharpness in his movements. McClarnon really doing as he pleases so far.
Can he find the punches, though, McClarnon, to force a stoppage here? He's certainly very high work rate. Almost looks as if he's on ice skates in there at times, Paul.
Sky Sports Extra, and on Sky Sports 3 from 5:30 in Scotland, it's Celtic against Kilmarnock. The British and Commonwealth bantamweight title fight for you later here. First, McClarnon against Paul at light welter, Jiminy.
Thanks a lot, Paul. Third round of this one, so far so good for young Glenn McClarnon from Lurgan in Northern Ireland, doing all the work against Bernard Paul. Paul briefly retired. Here he tries to come back again, but is it self-delusion? You're right, there's just no snap about Paul, is there,
no,
so far?
You can't get him set to do anything. I don't know if you've suggested the boots, or if it's a problem with the balance. But yeah, there's definitely something wrong with Paul.
He has just about run out of opportunities as well at the top level, Paul. Although most people still have him in the British top 10, he's holding on to that position really now by his fingernails, I would suggest.
There's no snap whatsoever in any of his movements or any of his punches. It's as though he's dead at the weight, and we know that's not the case.
Take it out. His confidence must be pretty low as well after recent experiences. Retired by his corner in his last 2 fights against Paul Burke and by Ricky Hatton.
Yeah, fairly devastating defeat against Hatton too. McClarnon's problem at the moment, he's staying in punching range but taking too long to get the punches out, and it's just little touching punches he's throwing, little arm punches, almost to get some leverage into the shots.
Quite a few being blocked as well. He's hitting arms and gloves quite a bit. Maybe just needs to pick the punches a little more, Jim.
Yep, A little bit more imagination required. Just wants to step off it slightly, give himself some room, look at what he's punching. He just seemed to be drawn into a little sparring session for a little half second there.
McClarnon was an Irish international and twice Irish ABA champion in his amateur days. That's a good left hand from him. Seemed to just make Paul look a little unsteady for a moment. Starting to open him up a bit.
See, again, he's letting himself get too close without letting the punches go. He's shaking Paul up then, and he allows himself to be tied up.
Little uppercut as well from McClarnon. He's winning the rounds. Paul just looks a shadow of himself, his old self anyway. Let's have a look at the British light welterweights. Good division at the moment. Shane Neary, who is going to box on after that terrific fight with Mickey Ward. Eamon McGee, the Commonwealth champion. Jason Rowland, the British champion, who Paul once beat in one round. Ricky Hatton on the up and up, of course. Junior Witter in there. Bernard Paul at 8 and Glenn McClarnon at 9. That's just our idea of the British top 10. There's no kind of official list anywhere.
Yeah, well, a tremendous difference in head choice, as you can see, 72 to McClarnon Paul. It just, Paul just can't seem to get anything off. Can't seem to get started.
Now look at those boots. It's almost Torvill and Dean stuff, isn't it?
Round four.
Funnily enough, though, you'd have thought Paul would have mentioned that to the corner and maybe they'd have brought in some stuff for him to rub the bottom of the boots on.
No, not normally what happens then is you score the soles of the boots with the scissors. But that's if they're leather soles. I would imagine they'll be rubber soles now, but I don't know if it's the boots or if it's something else. I don't know.
Yeah, I remember in the past with Vincenzo Nardiello and Nigel Benn, we had a pretty similar incident. And there he is, unsteady again on his feet, Paul. This is a curious display from him.
McClarnon wants to stand off slightly, give himself some room, don't allow Paul to tie him up. Just stand off, get some leverage into the shots. He's getting too close again.
He needs to start doing something as well, Paul, because Richie Davies, the referee, went over to the corner and said something between the rounds. And I think he wanted to see it getting a little more competitive, otherwise he'd start to think about a stoppage.
I don't think McClarnon has given the referee any reason to stop this yet. And it's time for him to move up a gear, get a little bit of snap into his punches. Once again, he's getting too close to Paul.
Still learning his trade as a pro, McClarnon. Again, caught by the right hand. He was usually pretty durable and resilient in his best days, Paul. And as I say, he used to be quite dangerous with the right hand. But you'd have to say tonight he's looked ineffective in just about every department.
Yeah, some of his right-hand punches have looked actually feeble. He says he doesn't seem to have the balance to get the purchase to let decent punches go. But McClarnon now really should be doing better. The fact that Paul is not performing, really McClarnon should be taking over here.
So can he really cash in and make himself look very good here, McClarnon? Still not really able to bring that guard down of Paul. Maybe some body shots might help to do that.
His work's becoming messy because he's getting once again too close to Paul. He should be standing off. He's good at long range. He's catching Paul at long range. Why doesn't he stay at long range?
The longer it's gone on, the less effective McClarnon himself has looked as well here. It's a chance for him to shine. He's winning the rounds, but not being that convincing, in all honesty. Welcome back, and you can see the Richie Davis, the referee, has again gone over to Bernard Paul's corner. I think he's a little alarmed at what he's seeing.
I think so too. I mean, it's the fact that Paul, he doesn't seem to have the balance to get any work out, and the referee's obviously worried about it. He can see it closer than anybody. I think he's actually stopping. Here we go.
Round 5. Certainly a long conversation, wasn't it, as we come out now for round 5. So Paul has lasted longer with McClarnon than he did against Ricky Hatton. No real surprise there, because Hatton is a very hard hitter. And you wonder how much that little excursion into the ring took out of Paul last time out.
Yeah, well, it certainly has the signs. The signs have shown of a hard career behind him. I don't know if he needs a longer rest or if he needs to rethink his life. But there's definitely something wrong with his boxing tonight. I wonder if Richie Davis was just saying, maybe get yourself into this fight or I'm going to have to take you out of it.
McClarnon, of course, as Jim was saying in the last round, though, has to give the referee good reason to do that. And as yet, you'd have to say he hasn't really.
He has. He's actually been fairly disappointing. I mean, the target's been in front of him since the first bell. He's got himself involved. He's been producing messy work. We're really looking for a big improvement from Glenn McClarnon. Now that's the range he wants. He's plenty of room there to get the punches off. The target's there. Then it just takes too long to get the punches going.
Again, sliding all over the ring, Paul. It's a sad thing to say and a sad thing to see, but sometimes fighters who've reached a good level sometimes just end up looking like a bit of a shell of their old selves. And I'm afraid that is the case with Bernard Paul.
Well, I remember before he boxed Hatton, we actually fancied him maybe to take Hatton the full distance. That's how much we thought of Paul at the time, but not in this form.
Well, he's throwing a little more leather in this round, Paul.
I think it's down now to the disappointment from McClarnon. That's what really is deteriorated. That's better. I've got to get the punches going.
Two good straight rights from McClarnon. Probably as good as he's thrown throughout the contest.
Still, as we're saying, he's not given the referee any reason to be thinking about stepping in.
Breathing more heavily and blood from the nose now of Paul. His gloves have come down a little.
So you get the feeling Richie Davis is looking for an excuse, but McClarnon won't give it to him.
Well, I just can't understand why the corner aren't doing something about the boots either. That was a bit better from McClarnon in the last minute of the round. Now, I wonder if it's getting to a stage here where the corner, too, ought to think about maybe pulling Bernard Paul out, because it doesn't look to be anything left there.
Now, there's definitely something wrong. I don't want to go saying that. We don't know what's going on with Paul, so I don't want to commit myself too much, but there's definitely something wrong with his boxing tonight. So either it's the boots, he's got nothing left, he's just recovered from flu, there's something wrong somewhere, but he's not boxing properly. The referee's noticed it, so there is a problem. I don't know what it is.
Richie Davis again. This time he doesn't go over the corner, but he's looking. Now he's going over to the corner again. You'd love to have a microphone in there, wouldn't you?
10 seconds.
I just think Richie Davis realises the same as we do, it's all over.
Yeah,
it's
he's called over. It off, he's seen enough. I think one has to say that that is probably right. Glenn McClarnon gets the win. He did land with some heavy shots in the last minute of the previous round. And I think for Bernard Paul, you hate to retire boxers because it's their living, but I can't really see the point in him going on much longer, because he gets to a point where he's in danger of being hurt in there, isn't it? Badly hurt.
It had to be done. He had nothing to offer tonight. Now, I don't know if that's the end of his boxing career, but certainly a long, long rest required, because he had absolutely nothing to offer.
Well, he had 6 months rest before this one, Jim.
Yeah, but I'm trying to be kind, Ian. My thoughts are that maybe time to call it a day. But a good career, some ups, some downs, but go on to something else now.
Yeah, it was a good career too, and he provided some good excitement along the way, Bernard Paul. But there comes a time for every boxer when they have to realise that there's not too much left in the tank anymore. And I'm afraid on tonight's evidence, that is the case now with Bernard.
Ladies and gentlemen, at the end of the fifth round, Bernard Paul has retired, unable to continue. Your winner from Lurgan, Northern Ireland, Glenn McClarnon. And please show your appreciation for a very game boxer, as always.
Paul is 34. Top of the bill tonight, Francis Ampofo at 32. But somehow you feel as though Ampofo is guaranteed to give us a little bit more, even at the veteran stage, challenging for the vacant British and Commonwealth bantamweight title tonight. Ampofo, former British and Commonwealth champion at flyweight, up against A.D. Lewis. We understand that Bernard Paul is announcing his retirement.
I gave my best, and I thank everyone that followed me.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, emotions of the moment, Bernard Paul has retired. Always very difficult at these times, and he'd like to thank everybody who supported him. And well done, Bernard. You've been an absolute pride to boxing. You will be sadly missed. We wish him all the best.
John McDonald wishing Bernard Paul well into retirement. I think it just underlines perhaps that this is an emotional business, and even for a fighter at the tail end, there is so much emotional investment in what they're trying to do, Barry.
Yeah.
It's the right thing, isn't it?
I think absolutely. He's Barry Hearn and his wife just congratulating him. Yeah, I think the guys, he was just dealt tonight and there was no snap, and his balance has never been great, but there was no, there seemed to be no grip in his feet. He seemed to be completely disorientated, and it's time to hang up the gloves, and I'm delighted that the kid has done that now.
What about McClarnon then?
McClarnon's a very good prospect. There's a very hot division at the moment. The light welterweight division is full of talent, and he's another one that can really produce some great form. He's still learning, and I think his reluctance to step the pace up, Jim and Ian were saying he needed to step the pace up. I think his reluctance to do that was he thought maybe Bernard Paul was playing cagey with him, and he had never gone that distance before, and he had to go 8 rounds. So I think he's got a very good prospect. He's got obviously a lot to learn, but great potential.
Top of the bill coming up here shortly, but more live action for you before that. This at featherweight, and it's Marc Callaghan from just down the road in Barking, making steady progress, this young man, 22 years of age, 7 wins in 8 so far. And up against him, it's John Barnes, solid pro from Sunderland. Featherweights, let's rejoin Jim and Ian.
So, sports fans and Sky fans, let's continue the action in the featherweight division. Firstly, and introducing to you, fighting out of the red corner, he's wearing the white trunks and weighed in at 9 stone. Brings a 13-fight record, 7 wins, 5 losses, and 1 draw. He's from the Premiership city of Sunderland. Will you please welcome John Barnes? And across the ring, fighting out of the blue corner, he's wearing the black trunks trimmed with gold and weighed in at 9 stone and 3 pounds. Bringing a 8-fight record, 7 wins, 3 inside the scheduled distance, and 1 defeat. He's from Barking. Please welcome Marc Callaghan. Time for the bell is Nick White, and referee in charge of the action is star referee Richard Davis. This is 4 3-minute rounds.
Hey lads, now remember, you must defend yourselves at all times. You hit the knuckle part of the closed glove above the belt. One of you goes down, the other goes to the furthest neutral corner. You do not come out until I say so. One thing I absolutely insist upon, fellas, is when I say break, you both take that step back. You got all that?
Yeah.
You got all that? Shake hands.
Well, last time out, Marc Callaghan knocked out Steve Brook of Pontefract, who was unbeaten at the time, and Brook was out cold before he hit the floor that night. Hadn't looked really a big puncher before that, Callaghan, interestingly. He's in with John Barnes here, who's a gritty kind of capable sort from Sunderland. He's in the white, Callaghan with 7 wins out of 8 so far, and the only defeat was on cuts against Simon Chambers. Some people think that Marc Callaghan might one day be good enough to get into British title contention, but that's a little down the road for him. This is a step along the way tonight. Black trucks, remember, of Callaghan.
Right! Sort yourselves out. Right clean with your towel, Callaghan.
Barnes, who boxes out of the Tommy Conroy stable up in Sunderland. This is his 5th fight already this year, Jim.
Yep. Some kids box for to become champions, some box for a living. That's a busy young man.
Obviously never out of the gym.
Callaghan's been won twice for the stooping too low with his head.
I was just going to say, Jim, there's a bit of a reach problem, I think, for Callaghan. He'll need to be getting inside.
Yeah, I think his problem at the moment, he's throwing his punches from too far out. He's going to have to step in with the shots. He's reaching with his punches, that was better. He's going to have to learn to get his feet a little bit closer before he lets the punches go.
Callaghan from Barking in Essex. So on home territory just about here in East London. He's been a pro for 18 months, he was a fair amateur as well. Barnes has won 7 out of 13 so far. He's a win some, lose some kind of operator at the moment. From Barnes there. Just finding it hard to get in range to land his shots, Callaghan. Can he work out the problem?
Just has to develop a little bit of smoothness. He's a solid looking featherweight, strong. He just needs a little bit of smoothness in his technique.
Promotions coming up here, but they're always well supported.
Yeah, but I think the small halls bring out the best in fighters. The crowd are right on top of the boxers, and this one's shaping up well in the first round. Nice little busy first round.
Yeah, look at that, there you are. You're never much more than about 25 metres from the ring anywhere here. Black trunks, Marc Callaghan, the featherweight prospect from Barking in Essex. John Barnes of Sunderland in the white. Barnes' career was interrupted by injury for a time, but he came back in May of last year. Not finding it easy, is he here, Callaghan?
No, he's in with a shrewd little boxer. But Barnes knows what he's doing. He's very compact, doesn't make too many mistakes. In fact, Callaghan's the one who's making the mistakes because he's having to force the moves. That's what I mean, he just has to kind of smooth things down, just shuffle his way in a little bit closer before he lets the punches go. Because he commits himself at long range with big long punches, and then he's wide open to counter punches now.
It's a problem he's going to have to solve as well, being only 5'6" tall. This will not be the last time that he's in with a guy who's significantly taller and with a reach advantage over him. Not very accurate at all, Callaghan, hitting the night air an awful lot. And it walked onto a right hand there from Barnes. It caught him flush. He took the punch well. Good shot that by the Sunderland fighter. Callaghan gets there with his own right.
I think at this level, Callaghan will probably beat some people just on volume of punches he throws. But he's going to have to learn the tricks of getting close without getting hit the way in. And be able to let 3, 4, and 5 punches go.
Let him go, Bones. Let him go.
Just getting a little closer, Callaghan, in the last 45 seconds or so. There's a right hand. He's started to find the range with one or two of them.
I've got too low.
Callaghan not bad on the counter. It might be an idea if he tried to draw some leads from Barnes. And when you're in with these shrewd little guys, sometimes you have to force them into making mistakes, force them to make the first move.
Barnes giving his usual honest workmanlike performance, and then he's put down by a left hand. Good shot. Caught him a bit square on. He was up quickly. Mandatory 8 count for Barnes. And the bell came somewhere in the middle of all that, and it couldn't have come soon enough. Here it is again, Jim.
Well, that was a knockdown out of nothing. Bang, lovely left hook, bang on the chin. Didn't see this Lahart Barnes, but no question. I think he was more embarrassed than anything else to find himself on the floor, but it was a lovely left hook. So you get the full body leverage into that punch.
Good shot by Callaghan. Yes. And remember, he knocked his man Spark out last time. Here's the third round of four then. Marc Callaghan of Barking in the black and gold trunks. Barnes on the floor in the second round. That was the first time that he'd been floored, and this is his 14th fight.
Yeah, well, he shouldn't feel too bad because it was a perfect little left hook, got him bang on the chin, and nothing wrong with his chin because he was smiling as he went down.
That should lift Callaghan.
You stay up as well.
He's only got 3 knockout wins in 8 fights, but I don't know, maybe there's developing power there.
I think technique's got as much to do with knockout percentage when you can land the punches cleanly. Power's no good if you're not using it properly, so maybe with more experience, more power will come. He certainly looks a solid little guy.
Looking for that hook again. Obviously his honey punch, the left hook, Callaghan. And a decent straight right through the middle as well. Barnes looks a little open to that. His defence just beginning to look a shade leaky, Barnes.
See, Barnes is committing himself now. He's been on the floor, he's probably lost the first round, so he's having to commit himself to get back into the fight here. So there should be target now for Callaghan. Now's the chance to let some punches go. Now that it's become competitive, Callaghan looks that little bit better.
Keeping the shots quite well, doubling up on the jab. Good body shot too from Callaghan there. Starting to show the signs of wear and tear, Barnes, in there. Callaghan landing with increasing regularity.
This is the kind of action that, Callaghan likes now. Close quarter stuff, he doesn't have to go looking for bams now. So really his work should start improving now.
I think that knockdown in the last round and the strength of that left hook certainly took something out of Barnes. There is Marc Callaghan, who won a North East London divisional title in 1998 with Newham Amateur Boxing Club. And that's what the computer says so far on punches landed. 16 to 50, not a lot in it, really.
No, but I think the quality of Callaghan's punches, though, slightly higher.
That's what the computer can't tell you, of course. They're working on it. Any day now, they'll have a computer that does that, too.
And we'll be out of a job soon, Ian.
They told you, did they?
See, this is the action that Callaghan likes. In the first couple of rounds, he was having to go looking for Barnes. Didn't feel comfortable. A lot of his punches out of range. But he's enjoying himself a little bit more now. And his punches, definitely better punches.
Strike games. Strike games.
So fourth and last round. And Richie Davis, the referee, says to them, cracking fight. Well done, boys, as they start the final session.
I think Richie might be taking over from the famous Harry Gibbs. He was a great one for chatting to you in between rounds and during the fight. Probably the best referee we've ever produced.
Yes, the great referee who died just a few months ago, sadly. He stopped one fighter on scar tissue before the opening bell, didn't he? Harry Gibbs once in Nottingham. Can't fight tonight, son, sorry. Callaghan's confidence growing. Boxing with a little more of a swagger now, following the technical problems he was having early on in the contest.
As time goes on, though, he's going to have to learn to get a bit closer to the target before he lets the punches go, because he's committing himself at long range, and when you step up in class, you're going to be punished for that. He's going to have to get a little bit closer so that he has a defence as well as an attack.
What do you think of him generally, Jim?
Yep. Certainly good potential. I like the solid look about him. I like the punches he throws. Just like everybody else, he has to work a little bit more on his technique. He has to learn how to get close with the chin down to let the punches go.
His right hand's getting through with some regularity. Callaghan did that well. Complaining to the referee. His Barnes worked in close. Worth remembering, it's only the ninth professional fight for Callaghan, and he's only 22 years of age. Plenty of time.
Yep, definitely something to work with here.
Barnes, workmanlike as always, but just unable to provide that something extra. First time in his career tonight. So last few seconds, and it looks like Callaghan's on his way to an emphatic points victory here, which would make it 8 wins out of 9 for him. Get the final bell any moment, not too much doubt about it. Callaghan has it. Barnes optimistically proffered his hand towards the referees. Fighters won't to do, but I don't think he really thought in his heart of hearts that that hand was going to be lifted.
Well, the stats have it fairly close, but I think it's fair to say that Callaghan was really the boss in virtually every round, and the knockdown just put the clincher on it for him.
So well done to Marc Callaghan. Continues to go the right way. And John Barnes, well, I said it was win some, lose some. Tonight it was lose for him. So how big was the margin? John McDonald, our MC, is about to reveal all, so to speak.
Ladies and gentlemen, after four rounds of boxing, referee Richie Davis has scored the contest for Barnes, 36 points. For Callaghan, 40 points, your winner. From Barking, Marc Callaghan. And show your appreciation from Sunderland there, John Barnes.
So Callaghan, a clear winner on points, and there'll be more learning fights for a while yet, I would suspect.
But eight wins in nine for this young man. So, Barry, armed with this glowing reference from Messrs Watt and Dark, Callaghan shows up on your door on Monday. What do you say to him?
Oh, he's doing very well. He should just carry on doing what he's doing and making progress. He's got a lot to learn, as the boy said, but he's got obvious talent, got power. He needs to move his head a little bit more, but he's making good progress and he just needs to keep on doing what he's doing.
Come back to me in a year, I think, is the answer. Yeah. British and Commonwealth Bantamweight title is our top of the bill here tonight, shortly. Let's size up the strengths and weaknesses of both of the principals. Fair to say that Francis Ampofo is about the most popular little man in British boxing, and he's had a very hard struggle in his boxing career and in his family background as well, Barry, so he'd be a well-liked winner. But at 32, what do you feel he's got left?
Yeah, I'll tell you what he has got. He's got big ambition. He's a very determined young man. He feels he hasn't reached his potential yet. He thinks he's been unlucky in a number of the fights through his career against Paul Lloyd, notably. He's been he's been unlucky not to have won. He's got Dean Powell in his corner tonight, and you know he's been working with Dean. He says he's in great condition. He always seems to have lacked that extra gear it took to get up to the very highest level. But against Eddie Lewis tonight, he's fighting a guy that's shorter. Come forward, he won't have to look for him. Eddie likes to be in your face. What worries me about Eddie is he does cut. We pointed it out in the tactics piece. He does cut easily, and these guys are going to be coming at each other non-stop, so there is a potential that it could be ended prematurely.
Lewis has matched Ampofo, both former British and Commonwealth champs at flyweight, but this man has lost to David Guerrero, lost to Noel Wilders. Does that put a doubt in his mind that the next step's just too tough for him?
Well, that's the big question mark. That's the big question mark over Eddie Lewis. Has he come to the end of the road? Has he lost his ambition? And nobody will know that until tonight. These guys are very evenly matched. It's very much a 50-50 battle. It's who wants it. That's what it's down to.
It could be very good. Certainly both men, value for money every time they appear. It's next. Super League action on Sunday evening for you. It's Warrington Hull from Wilderspool. Sky Sports 1 at 6:30. The winner in our top of the bill tonight can win two titles and rejuvenate his career. John McDonald to call out the two fighters.
My lords, ladies and gentlemen, it's the fight of the night, the main event. Please welcome into the ring now, from Bury, the mighty atom, Eddie Lewis.
Only 4 feet, 10 and a half inches tall, Eddie Lewis. flyweight, British and Commonwealth champion, like the man he'll be facing in there tonight. But the question really with Adi Lewis is, having moved up to bantamweight and failed to make much impact so far, are his best days already behind him at the age of 24? Chance tonight for him to resurrect his career a bit, Jim.
Yeah, definitely, and the fact that two titles are on the line today, there's a lot of strain on both guys, because in a division that's not too wonderful as far as talent's concerned, the loser tonight really has nowhere to go. Both titles will be owned by the one fellow, and the other fellow will be right out in the cold.
Fairly amazingly, it's the very first time that Adi Lewis has ever boxed at the York Hall in Bethnal Green. I thought it was compulsory for every fighter to box here within their first 10.
Well, he hasn't served his apprenticeship properly tonight. He's put that to right, thankfully.
Very much away from home as Ampofo prepares to make his way to the ring.
And ladies and gentlemen, please welcome to the ring now, the pocket battleship, Francis Ampofo.
There he is, the extremely popular Francis Ampofo, now 32 years of age, and it would be quite remarkable because his career did, before tonight, appear to have moved into an irreversible slide, but he has the chance here to become British and Commonwealth bantamweight champion. Just has to walk around the corner, really, to box here at the York Hall in Bethnal Green. This is where he's based. His 12th fight in this arena tonight. One of the most likable men in professional boxing.
Yeah, that's for sure. He's certainly well supported tonight. I think in Francis's last fight against Noel Wilders, I think Wilders' style just frustrated and annoyed him, and I think he got fed up halfway through, and in the last six rounds of the fight it looked as though he hadn't much left. But I think he's got a lot more left than he showed that night, and I think the fact that the opponent he's got tonight suits him much more, I think we may see a different Francis Ampofo tonight.
Well, it wasn't a bad effort by Ampofo against Wilders. He remained competitive, and his performance against Wilders was better than that of Adi Lewis, who got stopped much earlier.
Yeah, but he seemed to be chasing Wilders around the ring without really believing he could catch him. That was the thing. But tonight, this is much different. Different opponent, different type of fight. And I think he'll really fancy this one.
Should be a good one. There's the tail of the tape tonight. Lewis much younger by 8 years, in fact. Two of the smallest professionals in Britain. It's not often Ampofo is taller than his opponent. It happens here, though. He even has a reach advantage as well, both inside the 8 stone, 6 pound bantamweight limit. Lewis by quite a long way, in fact. Ampofo a pro now for 10 years, Lewis for 6. Ampofo's had, well, 4 more fights. Boxed significantly more rounds, but Lewis with the higher knockout percentage in his career probably has a bit more of a dig. Whether he has it at bantamweight, of course, remains to be proved. Well, Ampofo has completed the 12 rounds 4 times. Lewis has done it a couple of times. Stamina shouldn't really be a problem for either of them. More knockdowns for Adi Lewis, twice as many, in fact, and they've both been on the canvas, but not very often.
My lords, ladies and gentlemen, Ringside Boxing Promotions proudly present the vacant British and Commonwealth Bantamweight Championship. Sponsored here by AutoDigital.com, business and the net all together. All the officials have been appointed by the British Boxing Water Control. Here present with us at ringside, our supervisors, Cecil Ross, Dr. Ozzy Ross and Robert Smith. And a very warm welcome to our viewers joining us live here on Sky Sports and our listeners here on TalkSport 1089, 1053 on the medium wave. Our timekeeper of the bell is Mr. Nick White, and our referee in charge of the action and one of the leading referees in the world today is Roy Francis of Kent. Well, they are the officials and here are the contestants. Firstly, and introducing to you, he's fighting out of the red corner. He's wearing the black trunks and weighed in at 8 stone 4.5 pounds. He brings a 25 record, 17 wins, 12 inside the scheduled distance. two defeats and one draw. He comes to the ring as the former British and Commonwealth flyweight champion from Bury, where he is known as the Mighty Atom, Eddie Lewis. And across the ring, fighting out of the blue corner, he's wearing the white trunks and weighed in at 10 at 8 stone 5.5 pounds. He brings a 24 fight record, 17 wins and 12 inside the distance, 7 defeats. He comes to the ring as the former British and Commonwealth flyweight champion and former world title contender from Bethnal Green, East London, the Pocket Battleship, Francis. Let's get the action on then. 12 rounds of boxing for the vacant Commonwealth and British Bantamweight Championship.
I spoke to you both in the dressing room and I know what's expected of you, so shake hands. Shake hands. Have a good one.
Roy Francis, the inimitable referee, a security man for a firm who deal in priceless diamonds. He's a bit of a diamond himself. So then, what happens here? Big chance for both of these two fighters. Eddie Lewis in the black trunks. Both of them former British and Commonwealth flyweight champions, but now contesting those two titles at bantamweight. A good right hand from Ampofo. How much does he have left? He's been good value throughout his career. Lewis loves to come forward too. They won't have to go looking for each other. Bet on that much.
I think that might be Ampofo's main plan. Lewis obviously more effective coming forward, and he wants to back him up.
Well, early signs that Lewis may be looking to use what he would perceive to be his extra speed here, looking to get in and out with combinations and give it a lot of lateral movement. Now that's a little unexpected.
Yeah, well, maybe he's thinking of a long fight. I know in his flyweight days he didn't expect, didn't want long fights, but maybe he sees this one as a 12-rounder.
So he's not, by the look of it, going to indulge Ampofo in a head-on collision. Looks as if he wants to box on the outside, darting in and out, getting away with shots, zipping away again, and so far you'd have to say in this opening round, it's working a treat, but this is very, very early. Sharp start, though, isn't it, by Eddie Lewis, this?
Yeah, maybe he's thinking, and Popa certainly has slowed a little bit in his last couple of outings, so maybe the speed certainly in the first three or four rounds, and it's nice in a title fight if you can nick a couple of early rounds, get them into the bank without extending yourself too much. Not a bad plan, not Eddie Lewis.
The Mighty Atom and the Pocket Battleship in there, so I guess something ought to happen, fairly explosive.
Well, we expect a good fight here, and the early signs are good.
It's good thinking by Eddie Lewis, though, and Ampofo did catch him with a body shot there, and that must be the answer for him, to try to slow down Lewis. Nagging away at him, really, like a little wasp. And Ampofo cut him off on the corners. Good little right hand. This might be slightly foreign to Eddie Lewis's nature. He's already covered about 1.5 miles in there.
Well, I don't expect he'll be doing this for 12 rounds, but it's confused us, so I suppose I must have surprised Ampofo as well.
Well, the boxing tour obviously carefully prepared strategy here, Lewis, and he's won the first round, all right. Well, a very good start by Eddie Lewis with some sharp boxing and movement to win the first round by a mile against Francis Ampofo in this battle for the vacant British and Commonwealth Bantamweight Championships. Here's the second round in the London Borough of Tower Hamlets tonight. Black trunks of Adi Lewis from Bury up in Lancashire, the white of Francis Ampofo, now at the veteran stage of his career, a man who once fought for a world title against the excellent baby Jake McLaughlin. But right hand from Ampofo gets closer suddenly, right at the start of the second round, almost as if Lewis had forgotten the battle plan for a few seconds.
The problem for Lewis is obviously going to be when the fight so the pace slows slightly, because Ampofo is still getting close. He's not getting his punches off very quickly, so he well lost the first round. But he's still got, he finds it fairly easy to get close to Lewis.
Dangerous with that head, and Lewis will have to watch that because he has cut in the past. That's a good right hand from Ampofo. And Lewis preparing to stand in front of him a little more in this second round. Ampofo might have been caught as surprised as we were by Lewis's early tactics.
If Lewis is of the opinion that he doesn't have the power to hurt Ampofo, that could be a slight problem for him, because this, sooner or later, it's going to really be a toe-to-toe battle with the styles they both have. They're going to be standing their ground eventually. And Ampofo certainly looks the stronger of the two at this point.
Feet, Adi Lewis. And he's making Ampofo look a little wild at times. Ampofo's best chance, Jim, is if Lewis reverts to type and stands there in front of him and comes at him in straight lines.
Well, I think it's going to happen eventually. I think the main thing is Ampofo doesn't waste steam missing punches. I mean, if he's going to lose the first couple of rounds, the main thing is he stays strong. I mean, these rounds have taken probably more out of Lewis than they are Ampofo. He's winning the rounds because of his work rate and his variety of the punching, but it's taken more out of him than Ampofo.
And he does stand in close, he's caught by some body shots. Ampofo having his successes all right in the second round, but only when Lewis decides to stand there. Nicely. He beat Lama at the moment back in 1983.
Ampofo certainly up close, it looks the stronger.
So the 32-year-old Ampofo in the white trunks started to have his successes towards the end of that second round. Will score this fight, Roy Francis. He's coming quite light, isn't he, Adi Lewis? He's obviously prepared to use his extra speed, whole 1.5 pounds inside the limit.
Yeah, well, it's a good sign too. It's probably a sign too that he's taking the job seriously. Sometimes nerves before a fight can burn out the odd pound here or there as well. So he's obviously up for the fight. And his early boxing is good. And Mark Hardy is the first two rounds in the bank. He's had to work hard to get them into the bank. And that's what worries me for the future, because Ampofo looking very strong up close.
And getting him with some good body shots, which will have the effect as this wears on, if he continues to succeed, of slowing down Adi Lewis. Lewis used to be a quite poorly disciplined trainer by his own admission, used to shirk training, but then got very serious about the business and they couldn't keep him out of the gym.
but it's going to have to be in good shape because this is going to, he's going to be under pressure all the way. Ampofo won't stop coming forward. And the movement we've seen in the first 2.5 rounds already, it's going to be a hectic night for him. You have to say he's boxing well in the early stages.
Neat boxing from Lewis, but he mustn't allow himself to become trapped on the ropes. Unexpectedly, he's taken on the role of the matador here to Ampofo's bull.
Still worries me, he's using up a lot of steam, a lot of useless movement. But certainly it's working. It looks like he's going to get another round in the bank here if things continue.
Ampofo will need to score more often. He's having sporadic successes. It's like that with the left hand there. Both of them have scored 12 knockout wins in their career. Ampofo, though, in 24 fights, and Lewis in 20. Well, the boxing skills of Amy Lewis winning that round, I think.
Championship snooker for you on Monday. Live and exclusive coverage of the Regal Scottish Open. Stephen Hendry defending his title against the likes of John Higgins and Ronnie O'Sullivan, a cast of big names. And for the first time only on Sky Digital, you can catch one of the enhanced sessions and have a choice of three live matches. Live snooker from the Regal Scottish Open starting Monday.
And back to what they're calling the battle of the little big men here. A.D. Lewis in the black trunks, Francis Ampofo from Bethnal Green in the white, British and Commonwealth Bantamweight Championships on the line. Noel Wilders, holder of the British title, never lost it in the ring. But the board said if you're going to hold that IBO world title, you can't be British champion as well. And he didn't know that when he got in the ring that night for that IBO title. Not be too amused about that, Wilders. I do feel a little bit sorry for him.
See, I feel Lewis has done well in the first three rounds, but he really worked his socks off to do well. You know, he hasn't found it easy, he's been working at a pace, and I wonder if that's going to tell in the middle and late stages in this fight.
Both of these two usually pretty durable. Although A.D. Lewis was outclassed quite badly by David Guerro when he went for the European title, but Guerro is really a top operator, so there was no real shame in that. He's going to have to keep up a sensational work rate here, A.D. Lewis, to make this battle plan work for him the whole way. Sometimes he is prepared to just stop roving the ring and stand in front of Ampofo, but when he does that, Ampofo looks the stronger, Jim.
He looks the stronger, yeah. He hasn't found much accuracy in his work yet, Ampofo, but physically he looks so much stronger when they're up close. I tell Lewis, even when he's pinned on the ropes, Ampofo not landing cleanly. We haven't seen him knocking Lewis's head back with any punches. So even at this stage, it's a closer round this one, but probably Lewis's punches that little bit cleaner still.
Just made to look a little laboured and ponderous by comparison, Ampofo. He's not the quickest. And of course at 32, maybe the legs don't carry him around the ring with the speed of old, so you find it harder to really sustain any pressure on A.D. Lewis. And I reckon he's thinking that in this fight his time might come.
Maybe Lewis's plan is if he can do this to the halfway stage, build up a decent lead, then maybe when the going gets a little bit tough he can just hang on in. I don't think he expects to do this for 12 rounds.
Does have youth very much on his side, A.D. Lewis, in there. That's a good straight right hand from him as well. Picked that punch nicely. here are the British bantamweight rankings at the moment. Noel Wilder still at number one, despite being virtually stripped of his British title. Ampofo and Lewis at 2 and 3, and they're getting this chance, really, it's fair to say, because none of the others below have really stated their case very strongly.
No, it's not a strong division. It's a fairly poor division, but the winner tonight can maybe look to hang on to this title for some time. There are a couple of decent defences there, but no standouts in the division.
Wanted, new bantamweight talent for British division, quite clearly. Cutmen were doing something, working away in the A.D. Lewis corner. It's hard to get a view with everybody in the way. And Popo, no signs of damage there. But the lead man in the corner, Kjell Kruer, is Danish, because Ampofo does a lot of sparring out in Denmark, so he's taken over as the lead man for Ampofo tonight. Ampofo, who boxes, among other reasons, to support his son, an autistic son, who ran the marathon to raise money as well, to help with autism.
You would expect Ampofo's work now to be starting becoming a little bit more effective. If that doesn't happen in the fifth round here, then he's the one with the problems. He's been slow looking in the first four rounds, taking too long to get his punches off. So by the fifth round, if he can't raise the pace and get some more success, then we have to ask ourselves again, who's the one with the problems?
Jim's card giving everything to A.D. Lewis so far. I gave Ampofo a share of the second. Otherwise, everything to Lewis too. So Ampofo needs to start picking up some rounds on the scorecards here. This is more his kind of fight, in close. It's almost as if A.D. Lewis has got out a video of Ampofo's fight with Noel Wilders and thought, well, that worked quite well, I'll have a go at that too.
It could possibly work, because, I mean, obviously his whole plan is built around continuous movement and just getting the sharp punches off first.
Good left-hand counter from Lewis. Just seemed to stun Ampofo momentarily. That just might have been an optical illusion, but just stopped him in his tracks.
Ampofo still really lacking accuracy up close. Punches are beginning to look sluggish as well.
This is no real hand speed there for Ampofo. Sharply done by A.D. Lewis again with the combination, growing in confidence. He must be thinking, well, so far what I'm trying is working well here. Also, I've never seen him boxing this style before.
No, and it's working a treat. At a time when you would expect Ampofo to start showing his first successes, it's gone the other way. This is as good a round as we've seen from Lewis.
So something for him and his boxing brain as well, and his ambition that he's prepared to abandon his usual style to work out a scheme and a strategy. And it's a strategy at the moment that's paying off handsomely for him early on here.
And Ampofo's forcing everything. He may tire quicker.
Most emphatic yet for Lewis, I thought. Well, we've had five rounds of this battle for the British and Commonwealth bantamweight titles, and so far neither Jim or I have given Francis Ampofo a single round. You'd struggle to do so, wouldn't you?
Yep, and alarmingly for Ampofo, that's probably the best round we've seen from A.D. Lewis. His boxing was punch perfect there, didn't take anything. Picked away some lovely little combinations.
So here's round six with A.D. Lewis in the black trunks. The ever-popular Francis Ampofo in the white. And he calls himself the Pocket Battleship. Well, I don't know if he calls himself that, but that's his ring nickname anyway. Somebody dreamt it up.
Well, he has to raise the pace. He's been stalking Lewis, but not really pressurising him and capitalising on any mistakes. He wants badly a big round here.
Yes, his need is becoming desperate now, Ampofo. He's 32 years of age, and it's already okay being a 32-year-old heavyweight, even a bit older than that maybe, and still being pretty effective, but it's hard at these lower weights, isn't it? It's pretty old for a bantamweight.
And his problem is, Lewis is looking so sharp and so fired up. He's kept the same pace going that he set off with in the first round. No signs of a let-up. And Ampofo doing the same things in this round as he was doing in the first round, and they're still not working.
And he's buzzing a bit here, A.D. Lewis. And happily for him, no sign of cut damage either. We thought there might have been a little problem a couple of rounds ago when the cut man started getting busy in the corner, but goodness alone knows what he was up to, because there's no damage there at the moment.
There's a little sign there that he was going to back Ampofo up. If that happens, then Ampofo is in serious trouble, because it's only the momentum of his forward movement that's keeping him in this fight at all. If Lewis starts pushing him back, and there was a little sign there that might have happened, bigger problems.
Heads coming dangerously close together a few times here, and that was always going to be a bit of a problem in this fight. And it's a good looking left jab, and Popo was forced to give ground. And usually, reverse is not a gear he knows about.
Lewis probably been given more problems in this round than the previous one, but he's still coping with them so well, and still the better boxing coming from him.
Now step forward for the first time, A.D. Lewis, slick boxer. I'd say he looks as sharp as a needle in there tonight, doesn't he?
This is as good as I've seen him, and I think Ampofo has really thrown his cash into the pot here. I think he's raised the pace to try to get some success. So this may be a round that just takes a little bit more out of Ampofo. He certainly has tried a lot more in this round, but still nothing really working.
Well, it's all going swimmingly for A.D. Lewis so far. He's in control of this. Let's see if Barry McGuigan agrees with the assessment of Jim and I at ringside.
Yeah, I agree entirely. I think he's boxing brilliantly. However, I am worried because this is not his style of boxing. He likes to come forward, and if he gets into a crisis between now and the end of the fight, will he revert back to his old style and get into a battle match? For Ampofo, that has to happen, because I have him at least five rounds down, if not six. Andy Lewis is boxing brilliantly. His jab is beginning to work. A little short, stubby jab. He's moving side to side. His head movement is great. He's boxing brilliantly. Can he hold it together? I think he can.
Thanks a lot, Barry. Yes, it looks as if he can, doesn't it, so far, A.D. Lewis. I think he realised going into this. I'm sure Ampofo thought the same thing, but I'm sure that Lewis must have thought, look, I've got to get it right tonight, otherwise I'm out with the dead men, really, in this division.
Yeah, well, I think youth vitality and that little bit of snap, that's what he's put his wages on, and it's working for him. He's not getting involved with Ampofo in the slice. He's not trying to hurt him. He's not trying to discourage him. He's not trying to stop him coming forward. He's just been happy to box the back foot and just with that little bit sharper all the way around, and it's worked a treat.
Lewis, who began boxing when he was just 11 years old, he was spotted by Jack Dowd, who was in the corner tonight when he was 14. And they've been together ever since, trying to make things happen, and they did make things happen, and then it went horribly wrong for a while. Is this where the story turns back in A.D. Lewis's favour again? Good right hand from Ampofo, needs more of them, needs to sustain really heavy pressure, and he needs to do something too to just break the ring of confidence that Lewis has at the moment.
Lewis has been throwing a nice little left hand shot behind the elbow all the way around. A lot of times it's semi-blocked, but it's a nice little punch he's throwing.
Waving away with those trademark hooks into the body, Ampofo. looking to slow down this speed merchant he has in front of him this evening. Needs to. But be fair to Lewis as well, he's had superior hand speed and accuracy as well.
I think accuracy is the key word in this round, and Ampofo again has raised the pace, trying his socks off again, but he's missing so much. A lot of his body shots have been blocked by Lewis. The accuracy, the cleaner punching still coming from Lewis, but this is a fairly close round.
Ampofo getting there a couple of times. Lewis suddenly remembers what the plot was and is back on his bike again. Again from Lewis, picking the shots better. The Ampofo's coming forward and throwing out leather, but how much of it is landing?
Yeah, the volume of punching from Ampofo has certainly been raised in this round. He realises he has to get himself into this fight, but the accuracy is letting him down.
He's got big problems, Francis Ampofo. Fighter who keeps on surprising people. He's been written off a few times, including the by now famous incident when he had the brain scan scare and was out of the ring for a while, but he came back from that and proved his health and proved he was okay to box on. Won British and Commonwealth flyweight champions twice. He really never does know when he's beaten Ampofo, but look at that on the jab so far, Jim.
Well, that tells the story. That kind of backs up the lopsided points lead we have at the moment for Lewis.
10 seconds.
I've got him 6 points in front now, Eddie Lewis, in this contest. That last round was a bit closer, but greater accuracy, I thought, from Eddie Lewis. I don't know about you, Jim.
I scored that level. I felt, believe it or not, Ampofo, just with the sheer volume of the punching, he probably deserved at least a share. But the main thing is, he stopped a rot in my card. It's the first success I've given.
So round 8, due to go 12, of course. Good right hand, that's better from Ampofo. Big cheers from his friends and a few of his family, I'm sure, here tonight. Needs something big, Ampofo, now. Can he turn it around? With the jab from him. Looks a bit puffy around the eyes, Ampofo, but tends to have that look about him generally when he's in the ring. Don't think the eyes closing up. That's good with the right hand from Lewis.
Lewis, a slightly more stationary target here. A nice little right hand to come back with.
Has a little of the spring gone out of those legs of Lewis? If it has, it's going to make him, in theory anyway, easier to catch and pressure. That was just a loss of balance, I think, by Eddie Lewis.
This is another tough round. Same story as the last round, the accuracy again coming from Lewis.
Francis is the cheer and the chant from the fans here in Bethnal Green. Lewis is very definitely away from home. He's good.
Well, surprisingly, he's still stuck with the tactics, Lewis. I thought maybe we would have seen that for 4 or 5 rounds, then we'd have saw the old Lewis coming back. But he's certainly doing the right thing.
Well, I guess he thought, well, it's working for me, no need to change. When you're winning the rounds, why switch it?
Yep, and for me, this is a better round for him again here. And Ampofo again, running out of ideas, started the round reasonably well, but running out of ideas.
Punch and move tactics from AD Lewis.
Welcome to Lucky Boy, may I take your order?
A small town California boy.
Rob Roberts, Sergeant Mulder.
I have an eating disorder.
With a hunger that no all beef patty can satisfy.
I'm definitely a meat eater.
An insatiable craving.
We're looking for some kind of genetic freak. A carnivorous predator.
On a fast food pickup.
This man's brain was eaten right out of his skull.
Brand new X-Files, Sunday night at 9, first on Sky One.
More urgency in the talking in the Ampofo corner. They seem very relaxed with AD Lewis. And why wouldn't they be?
I think this is why we can see Lewis getting the punches home. Ampofo's slower punches not finding the target.
So here comes the ninth round. AD Lewis looking good at the moment to take the British and Commonwealth Bantamweight Championships back to Bury in Lancashire, a town where boxing is banned, incidentally. So you can never fight there.
I'm wondering now, should Lewis be putting a little bit more strength into the jabs? His jabs are landing so well. Ampofo is tired, the same as he is, so maybe just put a little bit of snap, because maybe start pushing Ampofo back. He's still picking away with the punches. Just maybe once or twice, step in with the punches and see that good right hand, exactly as I'm saying.
Right hand, good shot, rather walked onto it, Ampofo. And another one from Lewis, who's away again, quick as a flash. Watch the heads, says Roy Francis.
That's the thing that we thought before the fight, the heads would be bumping all the way, but we weren't expecting this kind of fight. We're expecting two guys going head to head. It's been totally opposite from what we expected.
Yep, it's been boxer against brawler, hasn't it? And all credit to AD Lewis for not only dreaming up this strategy, but carrying it out, presumably with the help of Jack Doughty as well. I reckon it's taken Ampofo a bit by surprise as well.
Yeah, but it's making him look even slower. I mean, he was probably training, expecting a toe-to-toe battle. He's probably doing a lot of work on strength and stamina, which is no good when you've got a gypsy moth in front of you there.
Just looked a little open for a moment there, Lewis, on the ropes. AD, nearly 2 feet smaller than Lennox. Still not accurate enough with his pressure, Ampofo.
Ampofo has never gotten to grips with the style of Lewis tonight. There's a few things you have to do when you have trouble landing punches. You don't just keep throwing the same punches round after round. You have to show a little feint. Try to get the other fella to make a move first. Think what you're doing. But Ampofo has really just come doing the same things all the way, hoping they would start working.
He's looked one-dimensional, hasn't he, in there? And he's got blood coming from his mouth as well now, Ampofo.
This is a scrappy round we're seeing this time. Both obviously feeling tired.
Look at the Bantamweight Championship picture. Paulie Ayala, who had to struggle to hold on to his title against Johnny Breedle recently in America. Tim Austin, big puncher, the IBF champion. We've seen him over here. Johnny Tapia, who's with Frank Warren, by the way. Breedle, one of the best of the European champions. Not somebody you want to mix with until you're good and ready. The Commonwealth and British being decided here tonight. and the, well, you have to say, lightly regarded IBO title held by Noel Wilders, who's lost his British title because the British board thought that was a world title he won. It was news to me.
Yep, a bad career move, I would say. I think they're both feeling a little bit tired now. That was a kind of scrappy round. Scored the even on my card there.
This is the 10th round then. Now, what can Ampofo do about this? Because he's running out of time, and you'd have to say ideas too. Outspeeded and outboxed tonight by A.D. Lewis. He's come up with what looks at the moment to be a winning fight plan, though there might still be time late on for Ampofo. Maybe just one punch could turn the tide here. That could happen, couldn't it?
Yeah, but I feel like if Lewis stepped in with a jab and the short right hand now, it would have a bigger effect, and he could maybe get himself in the driving seat. Instead, he's still boxing on the back foot. It's working well. He probably feels, why change it? And that's fair logic. His punches are landing so cleanly. Why doesn't he step in with them and see if he can start pushing Ampofo back? See, Ampofo is always able to come through the punches.
Couple of body shots from Ampofo. Again, though, the greater accuracy from A.D. Lewis. Like that. Little blood from the nose of Lewis. And he's caught that time by a left hook with quite a solid shot.
It's just still that the swinging hope that we've seen all the way through for Ampofo. He hasn't really thought anything out. When he saw the change in style of Lewis, he didn't think, well, what am I going to do about this? Am I going to come up with something else? He's been doing the same thing round after round.
Looks puffy around the face now, Ampofo.
Head's beginning to come together now. Both are obviously tired.
We've said it before about Ampofo, but this really might be his last chance to become a champion again. Feet for them as well, Ampofo. Well, we've seen a new and different A.D. Lewis. Is this the rebirth of his career tonight? Will he move on to a new phase? He's doing it well. What he's done is a little bit audacious, isn't it?
Yeah, well, he's done what maybe a lot of fighters should do, is think about the fight before you go into the ring. Have a plan and stick with it. And the plan's been working, he hasn't changed. I just feel, I'd like to see him stepping in a little bit with the punches. I mean, we only have a couple of rounds to go, so maybe he's feeling well ahead in points. Don't do anything silly. But I feel if he stepped in with the jabs and the right hand, he would start pushing Ampofo back and the job would become easier. He wouldn't have to cope with counter punches.
A little bit of minor damage by the right eye. Now then, here the red is Lewis and the blue is Ampofo, if you can follow these graphs. A number of punches land, and you can see that Lewis is landing more just about all the way through, except in the second round. That's what the computer says. It can do wonderful things. Can't announce the decision yet, though. That'll be Roy Francis in a couple of rounds' time. Now, there's a loose tape on Ampofo's glove. Have to just cut that off in case it flicks into the other fella's eye. A pair of scissors would help here. No,
they're actually better.
Look at this.
They're actually better putting fresh tape on the top. That's what you should do. Cut that and it's still wet. It'll come off again.
There you go. 21st century technology for you, see. Jack Doughty yelled at A.D. Lewis, don't stand with him.
Well, they're happy with a points victory and with two titles at stake, quite right. But I feel the job might be slightly easier trying to push him back. Because then that cheat there, he's still dangerous coming forward. If you can get this little fella on his back foot.
Here goes Ampofo now. His best period of pressure in a long, long time. Now, Lewis does try to get back on his back, but Ampofo grounds for hope there. Even this late, even this far behind. Now, can he build on that? He needs to just pour in the leather now and hope there's something will break for him. Signs, I think, there, with Lewis holding on the inside, but he's beginning to tire. He's covered. Well, it seems like a marathon in there, doesn't it?
Yep, I feel he's maybe missed the chance here. When things were going well, his punches were landing. He should have stepped in, I feel, and pushed this little fella back. He didn't do it. Now we're seeing a final burst from Francis Ampofo.
Well, Ampofo's corner surely must have told him what he has to do. And what he has to do, basically, is stop Lewis. He can't win it on the scorecards. We don't think, anyway. This is much better from Ampofo. Now the fight's a bit more in his territory. But it's extremely late. Body shot. He was hurt by that. A.D. Lewis is hurt by these body shots. Needs to get away from those ropes, and does. Little silly smile comes across his face, almost in recognition. Worst patch of the fight, this, for A.D. Lewis. He's not there yet.
Well, I don't know where Ampofo has found his strength. I mean, he looked devoid of ideas, as though he was just resigned to a points defeat, but he has found something in the tank. These experience of an old warrior, yeah.
These look big shots, Jim, these body punches.
Yep, and then the couple of right hands to the ribs certainly took all the wind out of Lewis. He's coped with them well, he's still on the move.
But it's getting harder for him. Last few seconds of the round, and Popo going for broke a bit in this 11. Easily his best round of the contest. A.D. Lewis could do with the bell to end this one, and it's not far away.
But to his credit, he hasn't been clinching too much. He's still trying to get on his bike.
Well, it's an Ampofo round. Now, what are they going to say in that corner? For goodness sake, keep away from him.
Well, I wouldn't mind now, even if he decides now to grab a hold of Ampofo a couple of times, just find a breather. He has the job done. He must realise that it's too late now to try to push this guy back, because suddenly Ampofo has his confidence for a final flurry, and Lewis is going to have to cope with that. And that was a big effort from Ampofo in the 11th round. Big effort.
Real tribute too to his professionalism and conditioning that he could do that this late.
Yep, and the fact he hasn't resigned himself to defeat. He's still in there with a chance, and he's taken it.
10 seconds.
It's been a superb effort from A.D. Lewis tonight, but whatever happens to Francis Ampofo, there'll always be a place in the hearts of most decent boxing fans for this man. This is the last round of it. Can Ampofo pull it out of the fire? Can he do it? Can Lewis stay away from him? Jim and I think he's a mile ahead on points, but this might be the longest 3 minutes of his life.
He's probably under orders just to survive at all costs, so we might see A.D. Lewis grabbing hold of Ampofo up close, clinching here and there. He hasn't done it so far, but you'd hardly blame him.
How much life is still left in the legs for Lewis? Still looks pretty fresh. Strong too, pushes Ampofo back. Chance of Francis. And those local fans desperately willing him to win. But I think Even his best friend would tell him he's a long way behind on the card.
Yeah, and I think the 11th round has taken the last of the gas out of the tank. See, now he's been caught cleanly again. I think that was his final effort. And quite right to do it in the second last round. But I don't think he has too much left.
Yeah, that 11th round, I think, was hard for Ampofo, but he's trying to lift himself again, but now we're inside the last minute and a quarter. These titles are in sight for A.D. Lewis. Unless Jim Watt and I are seeing something completely different to Roy Francis, the referee.
Well, I think in the last couple of rounds, at least Ampofo will leave the ring with his pride intact, because he gave up his best in those rounds. Never really got going in the early part, the middle part of the fight. But at least his pride has been restored, because a tremendous 11th round, he's still giving it everything he has.
Well, it's been a decent finish from Ampofo, but you have to think of the 12 rounds as an entity. For the most part, he's been outspeeded, outthought, outboxed. Last few seconds. There are now 10 to go. And Popo hasn't quite been able to repeat round 11 in this, the last round. Lewis can see the finishing tape now. There's the final bell. A.D. Lewis is the new British and Commonwealth bantamweight champion. And Popo offered his hand, hopefully, but I don't think there could be any doubt about it. It was a really very good performance indeed, that, by A.D. Lewis, who came in with a completely new strategy for him, but made it work. And that's what it means.
Yep, you have to give him full credit. He thought out the plan before he left home, or he started out weeks ago, and it's worked a treat. Full credit to both guys. And Ampofo gave everything he had, but he's always lacked a little bit of imagination. And Lewis shown all the imagination we've seen from him in his career.
Friends and family around to give him kisses. Barry Hearn, the promoter. I don't think he'll kiss him. But you can understand the ecstasy that A.D. Lewis must be feeling at this moment. Look what it means to him. Because he was really looking at a bad, bad period in his career. He needed this win, he's got it. How close was it? We'll find out now.
Ladies and gentlemen, after 12 thrilling rounds of boxing, referee Roy Francis has scored the contest. For Ampofo, 115 points. For Lewis, 117 points. Your winner, and the new British and Commonwealth bantamweight champion, the pride of Bury, the mighty atom, A.D. Lewis.
Well, it was a lot closer than Jim and I had in the
British
card. 5 rounds to 3, with 4 even, was how Roy Francis had it. But we thought Lewis was a wider winner than that. We'll have a chat to A.D. Lewis right after the break.
And Commonwealth champion for the second time in his career. Only a 2-round margin, according to referee Roy Francis. Points winner over Francis Ampofo. Let's get the verdict from the winner, who's with Ian Dar.
Well, before this fight, A.D., some people were wondering whether A.D. Lewis was washed up at the age of 24, but you provided a few answers there.
Yeah, I changed my plan. I used to come forward. He said, I can't go backwards. I proved I can. And I can't believe I'm a double champion at 2 different weights. That proves I'm a good fighter.
It almost seemed quite an audacious plan, because everybody thought you'd come forward, he'd come forward, there'd be a head-on collision, but you outboxed him.
That's what I told people. I told people I'd come and meet him head-on. Tricked him a little bit. I think he was surprised, and I just outboxed him, I think.
Had you been watching the video of the Noel Wilders fight with Ampofo and thought you'd do what he did, more or less?
I've done undercards of Francis for a number of years, so I knew how to box him. I've boxed a fight so many times in my head, so I was ready.
Rebirth of your career tonight with your mum and family here.
It's brilliant for them. You know what I mean? I deserved it. I trained hard for the fight, and they deserve it for coming down here to watch me.
Who do you want to fight now?
I just want to take a break and go to Portugal. Steve, if you're watching in Portugal, I'm coming. So I'm just going to go and have a break there, and then I'll decide when I come back.
Really sharp. Really sharp performance tonight. Well done, AD.
Right, thanks.
Barry McGuigan, was that one even before the first bell tonight?
That was a very good good tactical plan. You see, the tactical plan can go out the window if you're hit and hurt. It takes a very good fighter to stick to his plan assiduously, as the way Eddie done it, and he was brilliant. He stuck to it. He done what we'd never seen of him before. He boxed and moved. His upper body bobbing and weaving and moving around the ring, left to right as well, using his jab and putting his combinations together. Superb little performance. And, you know, fair play to Francis Ampofo. Can be a little one-dimensional at times, but fought with his heart on the line there tonight. Just couldn't pull it off.
Just a brief word about Lewis on the future, Barry. If he can adapt that boxing ability, and we know he's got all the other talents from earlier in his career, can this be a breakthrough fight to a new level?
Debatable. It's a tough division, the bantamweight division. And Johnny Bradal, who's the European champion, and all of the world champions are very good. They're another league up from this guy. In fact, two or three leagues up, so it's a very tough division. However, he can have a couple of good domestic battles and earn plenty of money.
Let's hope he enjoys his moment. Thank you, Barry. Just a reminder that this is the start of a wonderful month of boxing. Throughout April, this is the lineup. Johnny Nelson's in action next week, top of the bill on Saturday fight night, defending the WBO World Cruiserweight title against Pietro Arino. We're starting slightly later next Saturday night, 8:30, Sky Sports 1 as usual. Ringside the following Tuesday, as we look ahead to the big heavyweight showdown at the end of the month, Lewis against Grant. Ringside Tuesday evening, April the 11th at 8 on Sky Sports 2. Michael Carruth, top of the bill the following weekend at light middleweight against Adrian Stone. Back to the 8 o'clock start time for that Saturday fight night. Bobby Vanzi is top of the bill on ringside on April the 17th with his Commonwealth lightweight title on the line. Good fights keep coming. Wayne Alexander against Howard Clark for the British light middleweight title, April the 22nd. Two more dates for you. Keith Holmes against Robert McCracken on the 29th of April. That's McCracken's big chance for the WBC World Middleweight title. And that's in the build-up to the big one. Lewis against Grant for the undisputed World Heavyweight title, a special event on Sky Box Office, Saturday, April the 29th. Thanks for being with us tonight. Big win for that little man, Lewis. Bye for now.